So who's hungry to learn about knowledge graphs? I'd like to say it's a privilege to be here because I often think myself as a software developer in the Swissport group as the first reuser of great biocuration data. And if you don't actually want to spend too much time to listen to me, I just want to say, structure all information, use ontologies, and identify everything. And especially number three is something where we could all work a little bit better on. So I'd like to tell a story about SysBiopix, because we can be another talk about this and posters. But we had 32 nice images. But actually, it's more than 1.2 million images, because there are some logic to it. But Swisspot is a group of great curators, and the first idea is that let's just annotate 570,000 mappings between all the different Swisspot entries and all the images. But as a software developer, I should always pay attention to that I should reuse the work of biocurators and not give work to the biocurators. So we decided to use the actually already existing curated knowledge graphs that we have. And we have really nice, fair knowledge graphs, the gene ontology and the interplot, in this case, the subcellular location data. So graphs look nice in pictures, but the real thing here is about these little border lines. So you have a red border line and a blue border line. And everything to the left, my left, of the red line is only in interplot. And everything that is in blue is only in the Go. And in between, we have this shared space, where the one knowledge graph flows into the other knowledge graph. And the fact that we can reuse these mappings allows us to drive APIs and make these biopix usable for everybody else as well. So we really use this interoperability to decide what image to show, the same images for depending if you start with Go identifiers or subcellular location identifiers from Uniprot, and really use the fact that these knowledge graphs are linked and reusable and interoperable. And this is important because we always think of ourselves as biologists working with biological data. And we have our little borders between our data sets. But actually, there's lots of data out there that our users want to use, because very rarely do they just want to use one data set. They always want to come and interoperate and bring things together to add the added value. And when we pick up standards that don't allow this interoperability to be done easily, we make life difficult for our users. So there's lots of wonderful data sets available that we're interoperable with, that we normally don't think about. So the European Patent Office provides data in an interoperable way, and you can actually cross-query Uniprot and EUPA data. Why is that important? Well, pharma will tell you, patents is where the money is. Chemistry important, EU law is important, environmental data from the Swiss Confederation, all linked, all cross-queryable. There's borders between them, sometimes very formal ones, but we can cross-query. And that makes us happy, because it gives a bit of a fresh air, because if we can actually allow querying, then the data is actually truly accessible. And if they're interoperable, then it means we're not just interoperable with our own little specific subdomain. And even a database like Uniprot, which has like millions of users, is still extremely specific when you look at it in the worldwide vision. And it also has to be reusable. And as a developer, I'm the first reuser of the curated data. And we often see that people reuse it in ways that we never imagined it. And we must make it easier for people to do so. So what if there was just one humongous database? Okay, what instead of having all these little databases, we just had one of them? It has been proposed, it has been funded, and has gone out of business. But in practice, today you can do this. Let's take two very large ones, Uniprot and PubChem. You first recently saw a knowledge graph of 4 million edges. This is something like half a trillion edges knowledge graph. Can you combine them? Yes. Here you combine Uniprot, IDSM for actually doing some expansion it with programming and PubChem in a single database query without actually putting all those databases in one place. It's federated on the fly, working quite nicely. On that side, I would say it's really important that we link our data, and that we should always think about, where are our borders? Do we allow people to cross from my data set into your data set and vice versa? Do we really reuse each other's data, or do we re-engineer? Because if we do that and we don't end up with re-engineering, I'm missing a slide for comic effect. That's unfortunate. You end up with a world where you might think you're standards compliant, but your standard only works for a very small community. And then when you actually have to reuse the data, well, you basically have to rebuild the data to re-engineer it to go into the next step. And that's not real interoperability. If you say, well, I have a very nice round area, a nice round peg, but if you want to reuse it, you have to smash it through your square hole, is it really interoperable? Did you really make it reusable for users, or did you add a lot of expenses? So really think about that when you make your next standard. Do I allow my data to be reused in a real interoperable way without incurring costs? So thank you for your time.
Thank you. Questions for Jerven? This one there.
Thanks, Jerven. That was a really nice talk. I'm wondering actually if what you're doing is pointing to a way we can actually start to characterize the ecosystem of interacting resources.
Yes. And the first part of it is like, we're really good in the community to make database cross-references, okay? It's an excellent thing and we should do more of it. But it's really hard to actually even talk about the fact that you interoperate. We have no common way to even talk about identifiers for conceptual databases. Like, what's the identifier for enuprod, but not the enuprod record? What's the identifier for Ensemble or even the Go? We don't really make those. We only think about our entities, and we never think about our databases aggregate elements. So that's a real challenge to come up with.
Yeah, no, that's really nice. And then along those lines, could you maybe look at gaps? So are there gaps in your graph where, you know, there are possibilities for interoperability that we're missing? See ya.
Yes, definitely towards the genome side. That's both from the size and from the legacy and historical perspectives, it's hard to make new formats there. And you see things with like the genome graph work, the pangenomes, that it really allows to kind of link into it, and also the hospital side, but it's still a challenge just on the computational side, where identifying all the things is really hard. Because the identifiers become larger than the data, and the data is already large.
Yeah, this would be a really nice thing to do for the global biodata resource to do, to demonstrate. We've got to demonstrate sustainability, basically, and I don't think the funders realize quite how much the resources interoperate with each other.
Yeah.
So it would be quite nice just to even do it as a start-off for global biodata.
It's actually quite a difficult graph to make to show like how do you interoperate. So this is like the point where we don't actually have interoperable standards to talk about how we interoperate. So it's it's a challenge I've been feeling quite a lot recently in making certain graphs for documents. I don't see another question.
Any more questions? If not, let's thank Jerven again and